because that's where we are in 2018. I remember when I was thinking about my lieutenant governor candidates, I was leaning towards some really fantastic women. And there were a couple of folks outside of kind of my campaign who were just like, oh, no, no, you cannot have a all woman of color ticket. And I said, why not? How many white male tickets have we had? Have anyone ever said, oh, no, no, that's not going to be viable? And so my lieutenant governor, Sharon Blake, African-American woman who was a lifelong teacher, head of the Baltimore Teachers Union, we were the first all-woman ticket in Maryland for a very long time and first all-woman of color ticket in the nation. I just think that it's our time, and I don't think there's anything wrong with doubling down.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we're going to have to end here, but I know these guys would love to answer more of your questions. But one last thing I want you guys, just leaving this group in the room, how can we help and what can we do and what's next?
I'm going to make my shameless plug in part because I remember being up here, so I used to teach at Georgetown in SFS and in school of government. So I'd always make the aggressive pitch with my students. I would love each and every one of you to get involved. I will tell you that, you know, for me, you never know how much traction you're going to get and how quickly. It has been so exciting that in our first 24 hours even of launching the campaign, we had more social media attention than the entire field combined. And Jordan can... and that's where, you know, I wish it was a message about me. I think it's a message about us. And so to the extent that you can do a few things, I would love it. First, anything you can do to help us on social media, it is the power and potency of campaigns today. And so anything you can do in terms of Facebook, I know our Twitter handle is up there. It's also your easy way of accessing the ad. And please let me know what you think, because I get lots of folks who are just like, oh, no, no, if you're going to breastfeed, you need to go in a closet or in a bathroom. And I'm like, no. Not today. Now I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it in your face. So deal. But, you know, also if there's ways in which you can actually volunteer, we have really so many facets of things we're doing on policy, on social media, on canvassing and get out the vote. Not when it's 30 degrees, but when it thaws out, hopefully, in the next couple weeks. We'd love to have you join our kind of army of volunteers. And then finally, you know, anything, if you know any folks who have money, we would certainly not say no. It is the tough part of campaigning, I will tell you. I would love if I could just kind of get rid of call time altogether, because it would mean that I could focus exclusively on voter outreach, especially with women. Only 20 to 28% of political donations come from women. And so this is where it's tough, because I do say to audiences, as women, we do need to own the fact that we need to step up in this respect. And so we've got to put our money where our mouth is. And so if you know any deep pockets out there, would love if you could just kind of flag the campaign, but really just it's always sometimes exhausting on the campaign trail, as Amanda said. So I am always inspired and uplifted by the tweets when I get them late at night that are just like, go get them, or anything like that. So if you could fuel our campaign with the enthusiasm and the excitement I can already feel in this room, I'd really be honored and blessed. But thank you again for having me.
I am so excited to go make a recurring donation to her campaign to get 10 bucks a month. That's all I can afford. So three things you can do. First, go to runforsomething.net. You should run for office. Sign up. Join a conference call. Even if you're thinking about it in a year or 2 years or 5 years, we'll talk you through what that plan could look like and how you might get there. Second thing you should do, go to runforsomething.net/volunteer and sign up to help. We will connect you with local candidates. Maybe they're in D.C. We've got a couple great city council candidates here, or Maryland, or Virginia, or wherever you're from. You can knock doors, make calls, or maybe you're a developer, or a designer, or a sound engineer. Maybe whatever it is that you do, you can be helpful to a candidate, and we will connect you directly with them to make sure that that's possible. Third thing is chip in. $5, $10. It is not really about the money, although it is, and we need the funds. It is about knowing that you're in this for the long haul. It is showing us that you care about electing the next generation, the now generation of political leaders. Every single dollar matters, and every single donor matters. So I am so, so, so grateful to each of the more than 7,000 people who have given to us, and so grateful for the tons of you that will join them, because it goes a long way. The other final addendum here, which I get yelled at when I don't plug, is I wrote a book last year called Run for Something, Hillary Clinton wrote the foreword. It's a guide on how to run. It's why you should run, how to run, and how else to get involved in political campaigns. I curse a lot in it, so read with caution or listen with caution. But I hope you'll buy it and read it, and then maybe give it to another woman who you think should run too.
So if you are a black woman interested in running for office or no one, we have written the Black Woman's Guide to the Galaxy, which is on 3pointstrategies.org. If you're interested in the Movement for Black Lives electoral work, all you have to do is text EJP, which stands for Electoral Justice Project, to 91990, or go to ejp.m4bl.org.
Awesome. Thanks, guys. And I'd be remiss if I didn't say, come join us at the United States of Women. We bring all amazing women like this together all the time to talk about solutions to the problems we still face on gender equity. And we really want you to come with us and take action. So join us at unitedstateofwomen.org. And thank you all for being here with these incredible women today. And thank you all for speaking.
I'm Zach Shrum.
Hi, my name is Ricardo.
Hi, I'm Jaden.
Hi, my name is Dan Fain.
Hi, my name is Kehoe.
Hi, my name is Alex.
Hi, my name is Darsha Shah.
Hi, my name is Josh.
Hey, I'm Ari Goldstein.
Hi, my name is Max.
Hi, my name is Danny Marshall.
For the pure mind, her name's Danielle, and she moved to the U.S. from Nigeria. And during that process, she put in remedial English because she spoke with an accent. But from that, used a lot of that motivation to help her grow. To the point at age 17, she'd eventually run a 110,000 person school district and serve as one of the greatest advocates of student voices on the Board of Education. And that's owning it.
My own inspiration is Dr. Marcia Shadlin, Georgetown professor. I don't know her very well personally, but I am so inspired by the work that she's done on campus, leading the way in research into racial justice and in the work of the Working Group on Slavery, Memory, and Reconciliation to come to terms with our own past here at Georgetown. So we are so lucky to have her within the community, and I'm lucky to be one of the many people that learns from and is inspired by her.
A woman in my life who owns it is Sylvia Levy. From her work in the Women's Center to working with GASA as the Vice Speaker of the Senate, she really puts her all into absolutely everything and has made such substantive change on this campus.
When I think of women who own it, I think of Melina, who was CEO of the Corp last year. Melina can walk into a room of people that disagree with her and walk out having changed their minds, having them thank her for it, and all that with a smile on her face. She really owns it.
For me, it would be my mom. For the first few years of my brother and I's life, she raised us as a single parent, and she was strong, resilient, and she taught us a lot of the things that we know today.
One woman in my life who owns it is Mo Berry. She always pushes me to expand my own perspectives and always is really confident about everything she does.
So a woman in my life who owns it every single time, every single day, is my mom. She's not only raised my brother and myself, but she's raised our entire family, and I've seen her go through every situation so well, and she just takes up any challenge that comes up and owns it every single time.
Both my grandmas, they navigated different parts of sort of the American experience in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and one of them was immigrant, one of them came from a small town. It was a very interesting story to have heard generations afterwards, and I'd like to believe that I carry a little part of them in me now as I navigate the Georgetown
process.
What do
you think Ambassador is? I think everyone has to do their part in helping further female development in professional careers, and I think it's really important for guys to be a part of that initiative as well.
well?
To me, it means supporting those in my life I can and always approaching things with an open mind.
In the context of the Own It conference, I think being a man ambassador means supporting what the conference stands for and bringing young women together and really empowering them and giving them an equal voice, not only here at Georgetown, but also in the world that they're all going to be sent out into.
I recognize that women are incredible and powerful and that they have amazing stories to tell, and helping them do that however I can.
I guess being a man ambassador to me just means supporting all the women in my life to just, you know, in any way that I can, and just be the best ally that I can.
Being a man pastor means hearing every woman's voice on campus and supporting all the work women do.
Being a man ambassador is a year-round responsibility, and for me it just means highlighting the accomplishments and qualifications of the wonderful women that surround us that too often go ignored.
To own it means to be unapologetically you.
To own it, I think, means to really find the value in one's story and to be able to tell that with confidence and with joy and to have a crowd that's willing to listen. And so from that, I'm just excited to listen to a bunch of stories that own it, be inspired by them, and be changed myself.
To own it means that you uplift and empower women to tell their own stories and inspire others.
To me, owning it just means being who you are. Not feeling the need to conform to any kind of idea of being otherwise.
I'd like to believe that owning it means to have a strong sense of self and to know kind of, or to have a sense of security in what your role is, but also knowing where you can sort of push the boundary.
One of my favorite parts of Own It last year was learning about the incredible female leadership that's taking place at the forefront of science, medicine, technology, politics, and basically every field. So I'm psyched to hear from incredible female leaders again this year and learn about people who are making changes every day.
Own It gives me much more than I could ever hope to give back. And thinking back to last year, I really look forward to the awesome conversations of all the incredible leaders that come together for this one day.
I'm looking forward to the amazing speakers and hearing everything everybody has to share.
I'm looking forward to seeing all the hard work that the Own It Board has put into creating this summit over the past year come to fruition. I know you guys have worked really hard in getting these really good speakers, and I can't wait to talk to everyone and see what their ideas are.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Monica Raymond, Abby Stein, Simone Sanders, and Sally Cohn.
Hey, everybody.
Yup.
Hey.
Hello.
Come on, you can do better than that on a... Is it Sunday?
It's Sunday.
It is Sunday. Sunday. Yeah, on a Sunday morning. Wow, what a pretty space. All right, so you may have first noticed something, because you're very smart, which is that Simone Sanders is not here.
Yeah.
There are rumors she's in the vicinity.
Are we letting her on?
Yeah, is when she comes. Oh, yeah. Okay. Simone, listen, in my book, Simone can do whatever she wants. So I'm just going to tell you that. Like, in my book, she, yeah. So suddenly I'm your moderator. congratulations or condolences.
You're doing great.
So far, so good.
So far, so good.
All right, so wherever it has my name for these suggested questions they just handed me, one of you is going to answer it, and
okay.
We're going to do that.
I'm going to save
the harder questions for Simone.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah. That does seem appropriate, right?
Okay, all right. Also, I happen to know why she was late, and it's for the same thing that I said I wouldn't do yesterday, because I would be late to this. So I'm just saying. All right.
There's so many backstory.
All right. So the nature of the discussion we're having is about voice and speaking up and how you find your voice and feel heard in an environment where, look, in general, people feel voiceless and feel that the individual voices are suppressed, but also then the kind of the power and weight and noise of the status quo can be so overwhelming. And then in particular, as women of color, as trans women, as progressive women, as immigrant women, it's that can be an extra added layer of opposition to feeling heard and feeling acknowledged, yeah. Let alone equally heard and equally acknowledged. So, Abby, let's start with you. Can you talk about a time that you felt voiceless and what you did about it?
Pretty much my whole life since I was 20, until I was 20. But let me try something like that. Am I allowed to do an activity here?
Oh, yeah, you do whatever the heck you want.
I don't like sitting on a chair.
Chair.
I don't know if I'm allowed to do it, but I didn't ask, so I'm going to do it anyway. I want 3 volunteers. Good.
Wait, what was the question?
I want 3 volunteers.
Oh, 3 volunteers. Oh, is this a magic trick? Cool.
No magic trick. Don't know anything about that.
Oh, okay, sorry.
I just want to try to get, what's the biggest cultural memory you have from your childhood? Yeah, what would you identify as a cultural memory from your childhood? Just one thing. There's no right or wrong answer.
How would you define a cultural memory?
Anything. Should it be Harry Potter, food, music, your favorite celebrity? Who did you hate? Who did you love?
In high school, I think the first time I ever took part in like a women's anything, despite being raised by those types of women, was I designed my own and held my own V-Day event.
Okay.
A V-Day event, okay.
Yeah.
Eve Ensler, V-Day event. I'm going to recap.
You mean the vagina?
Yeah, good. You're doing good. You're doing good. You're doing it better than me.
There you go. Okay.
You're stealing my exercise.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so I think you said
cultural memory. Oh, it's Skylar. I just want to know if I can join the panel.
Hi.
I don't know if Sally Cohen will let me play with her today.
I certainly
did
that.
What was that?
Nothing. Okay. Go on. Abby's doing an experiment. I'm now the moderator, by the way.
You are the moderator?
Yeah, you got fired.
That's fine.
I'm so sorry.
I've been put out of worse places.
All right, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, so going to my first Eid celebration, you guys know what that is? So a big cultural memory
of you, okay. I think
recently going to
a woman's march. Beautiful.
Okay, cool. All right, cool.
Have any of you ever had an experience where you're sitting in a classroom and there are references made and you have no idea what they're talking about? Okay, a lot. Have you ever had sitting in a room and you don't know anything what they're talking about? Any movie reference, music, radio, magazines, TV shows, anything relating to the internet and so on?
I'm a journalist. So.
Okay.
Business journalist.
So you know a lot.
No. It's for IT and federal IT and corporate IT, and so oftentimes I'm speaking to very intelligent human beings, and I just gotta fake it till I make it.
Okay, beautiful. Okay, thank you all. Thank you.
Great.
This didn't go exactly where I wanted, but perfect. I'm gonna sit down again,
okay,
and I don't
want to
take too much more time.
Go ahead.
But I grew up in a background where everything that I knew until I was 20 is pretty much useless on where I am now. I grew up trilingual, speaking 3 languages, with 2 of them being totally useless. I am very, very queer, probably as queer as it gets. Sorry, I don't know if that's a contest here, but
We can throw down later, but all right.
Yeah, okay, cool. We'll do that. We'll do a boxing match later and see who gets it better. But I didn't know that it existed. I didn't know gay people existed until 2008. I didn't know trans people existed until I was 20. So when you're asking me, like, if I had a time when my voice wasn't heard, until I got to the internet for the first time, which was a terrible thing that I did when I was 20 years old, going online, it was one of the worst things I ever did in my life, I had no idea that my identity is even real. Mm. I had no idea that, not that I have a voice, that there is anything to talk. Forget about having a voice. Forget about being able to talk to anyone about it. Mm. I think that answers your question, right?
It does. So it was going online and seeing others, it's even giving voice that helped you figure out there even was something to say.
That I am real. Right. Forget about having, right. Yeah. And then okay. I had to learn how to be able to use that. And how to be able to help other people, which I assume we'll get to that later.
Given the mass amount of time I've given thinking about how to moderate this fantastic panel. You talk about a time you, similarly, same question, felt voiceless and how you either privately or publicly navigated that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm brown. Queer, I'm Latina.
Is that your way of challenging us on the queer?
I'm winning the queer competition.
Oh,
really? Hey, okay. We'll do that later.
You know what? Get this. It's not a contest. It's not. Go ahead.
Trying to understand. I guess like trying to understand all of those things as my identity was very difficult for me when I was a teenager. I think. And not understanding my feelings, not being able to talk about it because I was scared about what my parents would think. Mm-hmm. And I went to school in New York, and that's kind of where I found a little bit of my voice. So I was lucky because I had the community and I had the space. Kind of like my dad went to Georgetown. So I'm very excited to be here. But being in an institution like this where people listen and this is a culture of exploration. I got to do that in New York and that's where I found it. Mm. But before I got there, I didn't quite understand who I was or what was happening in my body, in my mind. I was able to express it as an artist. I felt comfortable there. That gave me a voice. But I didn't understand my power until I was given the space to do that.
And what did it feel like when you found it? Can you describe the
difference?
Feels
like I can do anything. Huh. Feels like we can do anything. When I'm watching these kids march yesterday, for the first time in a while, it feels like you have some hope for the world. I think our country's gonna be okay. I think they're in the right hands. And so like when you find your voice, like you guys are, you're giving us the chance to also fight for ourselves. It's very empowering to see.
By the way, I realize I didn't like introduce our panelists, but I feel really confident y'all can read, because by the by, I didn't get into Georgetown. I went to George Washington University.
Oh, did you?
I did. It's true.
Did you apply?
I mean, actually, no, I didn't apply to Georgetown, but because I don't like rejection. Anyway, it's fine. So I feel like you can all like find everyone in your programs and then we can have more time for discussion. I hope you're fine with that because I'm not asking your permission. Okay. Simone.
Sally.
I want you to fast forward a little. I mean, you can talk about when you found your voice, but I want to fast forward a little bit to, it's interesting in an era of, you know, sort of Time's Up and Me Too and Enough and all of that, and, you know, that I think people could look at you and say, well, she's found her voice, she's got her voice, she's, you know, got it all figured out. And I want you to talk about sort of current moment. Are there still times when you feel voiceless?
Yes.
And how you wrestle with that every day?
Yeah, there are still times that I feel voiceless. You know, I think because people think we're on television, that because we have this platform, and shout out to CNN, but because we have this platform where we can be, speak up, we can be our authentic selves, we can spar with folks on the issues, that we're absolutely okay and fine, and like we just live our lives every single day as though nothing bothers us. But there are often times, and sometimes it happens on TV, when I in fact feel voiceless. I felt voiceless when the former Attorney General of Virginia told me to shut up before people had their Cocoa Puffs one morning on television. And I felt voiceless, but I felt embarrassed. Because all I want to do is show up every day and do my job. I want to be able to show up every single day just like everybody else and just do my job. But because my presence, because of whether it's because I'm a young person, because that I'm bald, because that I'm black, my presence to some people is threatening, or my presence, or some people deem that I don't deserve to be there. And because that's how some people, you know, feel about me when I approach the room, when I show up on television, so on and so forth, they react to me differently. And I think that's something many people can identify with, whether they're on television, in the classroom, in the boardroom, in an organization. And for me, it's been really important to understand that I deserve to be exactly where I am, just as much as anybody else, that my voice is just as important as anyone else's. And matter of fact, my voice is extremely important because I know when I walk into the room, no one's going to say what I'm going to say the way I'm going to say it. And that is what encourages me and like helps me push through the moments where I feel voiceless.
Now, does that, I have a follow-up, but go ahead.
I was just thinking a lot about, because that's, I've heard that a lot, specifically people who come from a similar background to where I come from, where we feel voiceless a lot. The media has either an extremely exotic opinion of us or we are just called a cult, and which they are, by the way, but that's not the point. And we don't really get to express ourselves. And I have been lucky, which I, until today, I have no idea why. You two are in the media, you tell me why. But the media has been obsessed with me, I have no idea why. I have worked with every major network, but still, every now and then, for the stupidest reasons, I get shut down. And I guess I've gotten used to being called every slur word for being trans, but then yesterday, which was totally unexpected, and I was surprised that it bothered me a bit, I posted a picture on Twitter from the march, because duh, if not, I'm not there. And
you know that, right? If you didn't post a picture, it didn't happen.
Yeah, you're not there. Ahead, any of you didn't post pictures, FYI, you were not there.
Yeah.
And one of the hashtags that I used was Jews Demand Action. Mm-hmm. It was the only hashtag that mentioned anything about my background, anything about being Jewish, but I believe in that. I was there with a whole group of Jewish students. I really believed in that. And until now, it's still going. There has gotten, I don't know, I think it's a 20 or 30, and I'm not used to that. I don't have a few thousand followers on Facebook. On Twitter, I do. It's quite small on Twitter. And it was everything from all these arguments about Israel, which I have no idea where it comes up, doesn't matter that I'm quite critical of that also sometimes, but that wasn't the point. But all these arguments about all the typical stereotypes of how we are trying to control the world, how we are taking away the arms because we are communist and Bolsheviks, and how all of that, and like nonstop. And it was unasked for, but at the same time, I'm gonna think twice. I'm sorry for saying that, but next time, before I say anything about my intersectional identity, how being queer and Jewish, or how being Jewish and an activist affects me, I was effectively shut down to some extent.
It makes you think before you do it again.
The thing is that, like, even though we're going to face being shut down because of our intersectionality, doesn't that mean that we have the right to be even louder?
Oh yeah,
right? There's a space where
scream.
People right.
Oh,
so
yeah.
When I get shut down like that, it challenges me. I said, "Oh, okay, I see. You have fear. Mm-hmm. This isn't about me. What other people think about you is none of your business, right? So, this isn't about me. This is about you."
Okay. You got to give me lessons.
But like, no.
I think, you know, hashtag whatever you want.
Oh yeah.
And how other people interpret it is a reflection of their experience. But it's our responsibility to stay true to our experience. Yeah. And so I think that's really badass of you, and I think you keep doing that.
I mean, I'll say, I think obviously in that exit, it was a hashtag, it was a good hashtag, like you're not, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And all of the hate that happens online, you have to take with a grain of salt.
Of course.
But Simone, the follow-up question, which this fits really well with that I wanted to ask you is, are there times where, how do you handle the balance between sort of when you feel shut down, when you feel like your voice is being challenged, not even because of the substance of what you're saying, but because of who you are and just showing up? How do you balance, on the one hand, hearing what might be some feedback that you want to take into account, mm-hmm. right? Or maybe I'm not being heard, maybe I'm, and on the other hand, being like, screw that. Or I'm gonna be even more aggressive, and that's even a danger, right? I'm gonna do it even more, and it creates kind of a false confrontation and feels like you're pushing yourself into a box that they, in a way, created. You have to be even more X.
Yeah, so one, I think that it's helpful. So one, I'm very good at constructive criticism. Like, I receive it, and I think for folks, we're talking about, like, speak up or they won't hear you. I think if you are speaking up, you also have to be willing to take constructive criticism. Because we only know what we know, and a lot of us don't really know too much. Like, we don't. The silos that we participate in every single day only reinforce what it is we think we know. Mm-hmm. There's literally a button on many social media sites that says hide all content like this. Mm-hmm. So that you don't have to see. So we are engaging and reinforcing what we think we know every single day. So I think we just have to have a good filter. But you also have to understand that a lot of times when people are bringing things to you, whether it be their perspective, their words, or whatever, like they have a certain thing that colors what it is that they're saying, why that they're saying. Like, they have a lens that they are also looking through. And so I think we have to be really good, and I've gotten really good at kind of filtering some of it out. But I'm also very comfortable with myself. And so I talk a lot about the concept of, like, using our authentic voices and being our authentic selves in every single space and place that we're in. And I think that is vital. Because when you are truly your authentic self, when you are using your authentic voice, when you're bringing your whole self to everything it is that you're doing, understanding that you don't know it all, I think our voices are that much better. Our platforms are that much fuller. We are much more realistic and able to shift the conversation and quote unquote change the world if that's what we want to do. But so many people are engaging Sally and they are not their authentic selves. Folks showing up as Sasha when they should be showing up as Sally. Like, if I showed up as Sue every day and I didn't show up as Simone, there would be some things y'all wouldn't be getting.
Amen, preach, sister. It's Sunday. Go ahead.
So, I mean, to that point, there are some people, when you talk about, like, when folks give you something or say something or are critical of you or try to shut your voice down, sometimes we aren't showing up as our authentic selves. And that's something we have to work on with ourselves. I talk about the fact that I don't have a work voice. Y'all know what the work voice is? Mm-mm. You know, the thing that you put on like this to sound a little bit more palatable if you're a woman or if you're a person of color, to sound a little bit more mainstream because someone told us that this is in fact mainstream. Okay, girl, how you doing?
Oh, hey!
And you know, you just didn't, you know, your work voice might be on your voicemail or a conference call or in a meeting or in class, you're gonna raise your hand, and I don't have that voice anymore.
But you, wait a second, but that's an important distinction. Thank you, Claire. But wait. I don't believe you have it anymore.
I don't have that voice anymore.
You did have it once. So what happened?
I realized.
When did you decide?
I decided I didn't have a work voice anymore in the beginning of 2015. I was working for a consumer advocacy think tank doing trade, and I knew nothing about trade. So you talk about, have you ever been somewhere with somebody and you don't know nothing? I didn't know nothing about trade. But I was the press person. So I learned something about trade real quick, but I realized that
even right there is a big admission, because can you imagine how many mediocre white boys there are who are like, I'm an expert on trade.
Yes, I knew nothing. Exactly.
I looked it up on 3 Wikipedia sources. So.
Exactly. Yeah.
But anyway.
I found my work voice in this job, because I was going to work every single day with people who were their authentic selves, who didn't have a problem espousing their views in the meeting. I would often go into spaces. We worked with a lot of the unions and a lot of members of Congress offices and whatnot, specifically on progressive trade policy. And oftentimes, I was the only person of color in the room. And so I just found out that I was running up against a brick wall, but Tom, Sue, and Joe and them, they're being their authentic selves every single day. And so finally, I was like, you know what? We're just going to show up as Simone today. And if I think that's bad, I'm going to be like, you know what? It's a no. Mm-hmm. It's a no. If I just thought I would stop trying to put on this facade of what I thought was professional, what I thought was going to work for me in this environment, and just be myself. Because being myself is how I got the job, and it was a process of doing that. But the day I decided to be my authentic self and show up as Simone every single place that I went, everything just got better for me. Mm. And so it is a process for us to be our authentic selves. But we can't talk about, like, speaking up and changing the world and shifting and moving systems and, like, breaking down the patriarchy. Sorry, fellas. But we can't talk about none of that
addressing systems of sexism, racism, if we are not our true authentic selves, because it requires our full selves to do this work. So I am my full self every single day, and sometimes that leaves me exposed. I have left the studio plenty of many times upset and
you
in tears.
Don't say.
Right? Because the things that we're talking about and that we're engaging with, right, like these are issues
real.
Of humanity. We're like, I can have a high-level policy conversation with you about the economy, about now trade policy, about tax reform, but if, you know, if we get into a conversation about white supremacists and you keep asking me why I always got to bring up race, I'm like, girl, because it is about race for me and so many other people every single time they leave the house. But we've been tricked that we live in this colorblind society. So I fully believe in people being their authentic selves. And we
and it's
need
worked
to talk
out
more
for you. I mean, that's the other thing is like, it's worked out for you.
It's
right?
Working.
It worked out for you. You seem like both to be like in yourself and also in the world. Like, it's worked out for you.
Absolutely.
Monica, authentic voice is a complicated thing in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because you're.
That's a nice way to put it.
Anyway, thank you.
I don't talk much.
Right? Because both you are literally your trade depends on your ability to assume different voices and different roles. And often, the assumption has often been in Hollywood that, you know, your own voice, your own presence, your own visibility, you wait. You put that stuff off until you're famous,
mm-hmm.
you know? And in the beginning, you lay low, you be whoever they want you to be, and, you know, literally, you are hired to play roles, but you're also supposed to play the role of the, you know, conventional ingenue in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
How do you wrestle with both your own voice in that sense, and do you think that's changing?
Well, you know, we learned that life is short, right?
Mm-hmm.
We don't have a lot of time. And I figured that out pretty quickly, and I'm just kind of tired of pretending like I'm going through the motions of doing this. I'm going to be loud now, and I'm going to be proud, and that's just something that comes, I think, with experience. It's important, I think, to be quiet and learn and listen and watch the room, observe, take notes, gather information, get smart. But once you've gathered enough information, then you can act. And to be able to act thoughtfully and mindfully is something that, you know, takes practice, and that's something I think I have to practice for the rest of my life. But navigating Hollywood is like navigating any other industry. There will always be people who think they know more. There will always be people telling you that you are wrong. There will always be people telling you to shut up. That's kind of how it goes. There are cruel people in the world, you know? That's just how life is. But finding what you believe in, and for me as an artist, I have learned that I need to be a part of things that are greater than myself. I understand that now, I see that. It's just a lot of Hollywood, a lot of media and entertainment. It's very selfish, the drive, the motivation behind the engine, like the perpetuum mobile, right? Like this gumption. It's all about me.
You don't
but,
say. Okay, go on.
Yeah,
go on.
Yeah. You know, everyone's into them. So
me too.
Me too.
But go on. Yeah, it's fine. All right.
And then you realize, oh, it's not, right? It's actually about something greater. And to be able to live from that place of collaboration and like, I don't even know what I'm saying. I'm just saying.
You're making a lesson. Have you felt though, or have you worried about being outspoken at this stage
yes.
in your career and
yes.
what that's gonna do? And,
yeah,
and
I have
talk
worried about
that. Because I'm sure that relates to anyone in any industry who's going in not as the Simone in 2018, but the Simone in 2015 or 2014.
Yeah. Yeah.
How do you think about that challenge?
This is something I would like to talk to you about. Well, because like, I don't know. I don't know what the answer is. Like,
but you're
I don't know how to navigate it.
So, but you're out there. Like, clearly you're talking about
You made the choice.
The thing.
Talking
you're out
about
there.
My thing. I'm
yeah.
talking,
you're talking
about
your thing.
I also,
so long,
but I also
do you,
don't.
Are you concerned about talking about your thing?
Like, are you worried it's going to have a detrimental effect on your career?
No, not anymore. I used to be.
Okay, that's cool. So what changed? Is it something about you that changed or the world that changed?
I think it's about me that changed, about life that happens to you, right? You've gone through trauma, you've had loss, you've had ups and downs. So when those things happen, you start to understand that the impermanence of life, and you understand that kind of like how transient it all is and transparent it all is. And so then I think when you don't care as much what other people think, and I can stand behind what I want to say or how I feel or my political views and understand that maybe
maybe it would affect my career. I don't know, but that's not really my problem. Mm. It's the only thing that I have of control over is how I want to live in the world and be in the world.
That's nice. So, Abby, I want to talk about, there's this sort of other side when we talk about having a voice that is often thrown in our sorts of faces, right? In that having a voice sometimes shuts other people down. And I want to hear your thoughts on, is there some, we can get all indignant in the face of that challenge, but is there some indignance to that? And is there a different, or is there some rightfulness to that? And is there a difference between calling someone out and calling them in? And how do you think about, or do you think about how you use your voice and claim your space
and how that affects
in relation to the space and voices of others?
Yeah, so I actually, as I've mentioned before, and I have a bit of a hard time understanding it because, I mean, I was the first person to come out of the community where I came from, but the way, and again, you all know that probably, the way the media presented it wasn't that accurate. It was really interesting. And a lot of people were like, you came out of, literally, my first big TV appearance on with the CNN, with Great Big Story, you know, like a CNN
sure.
network,
yeah, we know.
Was a few two months after coming out. And I got, like, when you were telling also, like, people, like, always, like, say, like, you can't do that right now. You gotta, like, wait your turn. Yeah. Or, like, you're taking up too much space. You're doing too much. And I think that about a lot because sometimes I don't even get it. Like, I don't know why certain requests that I get to speak at certain places, like here, I kept on telling people, I'm like, I'm speaking with like three real big amazing people. I have no idea who decided to put me on stage here.
Now, come on.
But also with so many other places, like I've done so much. I am 2.5 years in and I'm about to publish a book. I am working on a lot of other stuff. And I feel sometimes that maybe I should yield the space. However, I guess part of it is the fact that I don't see someone else doing that specifically. So like sometimes coming from a crazy
there
background.
There are just not that many trans folks coming out of the Hasidic Jewish community.
Forget about the Hasidic community.
It's true.
Forget about the
It's
Hasidic
not
community.
Like, make room for all the others, Abby.
But even like from
you
other
You Hasidic trans hog. Not,
you
I
see
don't,
that otherwise.
I don't see that happening.
Leave me out of it. It doesn't.
Okay,
right.
Go on.
But
sorry.
At the same time, they are a bit more talking about other fundamentalist communities because,
yes.
Surprisingly enough, I have more in common with I have more in common with people come from Amish communities than I have with you as another Jew.
Probably.
Totally.
True. I get
I'm talking
that.
Culturally, religiously,
every
way.
Yeah, I get that.
So there is this place of I am not the only one. But at the same time, because I see there's no one else doing it, I would stand up and do it. And I'm constantly like, if there's someone else who's trying to come in, if someone has arguments, please let me know. But I don't think I have to get off
stage. Yeah, I guess I'm asking something different. I'm asking that a lot of, like, there are a lot of straight male cis conservative types who say, like, hey, I no longer feel like I have the freedom and I don't have the voice and I've been silenced. Because I can't say X, Y, Z,
that
P,
That is
or
just
Q.
not true.
I want to know, do you think about that? Do you think,
about how you create,
because there have historically been, certainly in the area of queer rights, there's certainly been a more, you know, sort of we're here, we're queer, get used to it, and more of a sort of like, listen, let's, like, my liberation doesn't threaten your liberation, our liberation's bound together, like a sort of more kumbaya kind of approach too. And I want to know how you think about that in relation to voice.
So I think one of the big misconceptions has been that we are trying to be against everyone else. We are trying that trans people are trying to become the new cis people. We are trying to be that this is the norm and everyone else's norm is not and everyone else's voice is invalid. And while I would call myself what I would call a gender warrior, I would love to, what Kate Bornstein would call fuck with gender as much as I can, pardon my language.
It's okay, my daughter's here, but it's fine.
Sorry.
She didn't hear,
forgive
it's okay,
me.
She wasn't paying attention
I would
to
want
that,
to.
So.
I would want to mess with gender, but at the same time, at least at the moment, we are still using, like, we need you. Mm. There's only so much that I
moment.
Can do.
I'm just kidding.
No, at least at the moment. I don't know what, and I think we will have to revisit this question in 10 years. We will have to revisit this question in 20 years. But at the moment, there's only so much that I can do that at the end of the day, I'm going to need all of you, which is also something that is, I think, really important when you talk about voice, which is that we think a lot about, and I think that also relates a bit to your question, like the balance between how much when we talk about trans issues should be trans people, how much should be allies. The same about race, about socioeconomic status, about sexuality, like how much of it do we do and how much do we let to the people who are, like what you said, the straight white male, how much do we let our allies talk? And that is a balance that I am focusing on every day because I'm limited.
There's
no yes and no answer.
So let me just sort of new moderator point of order. Oh, fudge. Really? Okay, well, that answered my question. So in the apparent 1 minute we have remaining, Simone, I want to ask you, do you have an internal, and this is kind of goes to the point that others have raised about you do hear the critics. Mm-hmm. They do get in there. And there's a way in which that can sort of make you self-silence almost proactively. Mm-hmm. And I want to know how you, but you also said you like constructive criticism. How do you wrestle with that and find your authentic voice in the middle?
I am, and I think we should all be really aware that we all come to everything with a level of bias. Like, we all do. Like, people are making judgments about me when I walk into the room, not knowing anything about me, but they just know that I am black and I'm bald. That's all they know, and that I have great nails.
Great nails.
That is how I help filter the understanding that there are boxes and biases that everyone comes to the conversation with. And there are times where, you know, I've said some things that people that I really respect will pick up the phone and call and say, hey, now, this isn't what we should be saying. You shouldn't be doing it like this. But I also think about the fact that when I think about speak up or they won't hear you, that we have to pick ourselves. Because there are sometimes, it doesn't matter how talented you are, how smart you are, if you are in fact the best, sometimes they, whoever the proverbial they is, still will not pick you. Mm. And when people give me the criticism, I think about the fact that the proverbial that they didn't pick me. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They never picked me. One lady told me that I wasn't palatable enough for cable television. I went on like 27 interviews before the Bernie Sanders people randomly called me. Like, all these things have like happened, and we have to end now. But I will note that sometimes we have to pick ourselves in many instances, because if I didn't pick myself, I wouldn't be sitting here with you today. So that is what I think about when people give me their quote unquote constructive or non-constructive criticism and what parses and pieces I want to use and incorporate. But our voices are extremely, extremely important. But if we continue to live in the boxes that society has presented for us, like, some voices you'll never hear.
Amen. Yeah. So join me in thanking Simone Sanders, Monica Raymond, Abby Stein.
Thank you, Sally.
I'm the
moderator.
Wait.
My daughter's here. She's passing out flyers for my forthcoming book, The Opposite of Hate. You can all get on April 10th. And thank you. Is that it? Do I have to give them any instructions? Go forth. Okay. Do other things.
And thanks don't shut
here.
Up.
Yeah. And don't shut up.
Ever.
Are we gonna take a picture?
Please head to your first breakout session, which will begin at 11 a.m. After your breakout session, lunch and the marketplace will take place in the Healy Family Student Center for 1 hour from 11:45 a.m. to 12:45 p.m., after which you will head to your second breakout session, which begins at 1 p.m. At 1:45 p.m., please return to Gaston Hall for the rest of the day. Please refer to your program or find a volunteer with any questions. Thank you.